So I think with the group, I thought, let me share this whole thought around digital. I'm sure some of these charts might look a little rudimentary, but I thought it sets the context of what we wanted to discuss. This discussion is more about emergence of digital as a very competitive edge in this connected world. How the new age businesses are using it to the success formula. Personally, I've seen a lot of businesses that have been able to quite succeed using this. And I think this is a forum where we have a lot of budding entrepreneurs raring to prove themselves, a lot of proven entrepreneurs as well. But I think all of us together, I think it's a wonderful opportunity if we were to look at some of these businesses, how they've been able to scale it up using these digital opportunities. And of course, a little bit of how we tackle this opportunity and at the end, probably open it up to a lot more questions that we can discuss. This is one of my favorite charts. I figure out a way to put this chart in any presentation that I make. These are some of the innovations that I think have shaped the world today as they are. Be it the bulb, be it the electricity, be it the motor car, be it the first telephone, the internet. I think of late, we are fortunate probably to witness two such areas that are probably reshaping this whole world today. The smartphone in particular and the cloud. In the years to come, I think these two potential innovations or breakthroughs are going to determine a lot of business models. They're already shaping up a lot of business models. They are in fact going to be shaping up a lot more of the business models as we move forward, be it in areas of healthcare, be it in areas of technology, consumer. I think some of these innovations have been path-breaking, and these two innovations in particular, as we move forward, my belief is going to be a very strong lever for growth for most of the industries and most of the countries in particular. This combined with this internet has become a potent weapon that's actually been redefining a lot of boundaries across the globe. To me today, if you were to look at, and the reason why I look at it so positively is it's a completely connected world. And it's nothing new, but I think if you were to look at, I think today, we are a completely connected world, a connected globe, people, devices. Of course, this connectivity also led to a sort of the pandemic spreading across, but that's a very unique case that we had. But I think at large, if you look at today, we are far more connected today across the world. And as they say, as the butterfly flies, I think we are far more connected to very small events that happen across the globe today. Connected people and therefore connected devices. And this, I think, is the biggest change that is actually influencing consumer behavior, political behavior, the way the countries behave today. A lot of this actually is connected to this. But if I were to look at it from a business perspective, what is this doing? It is generating tons and tons of information and insights today. I mean, gone are the days that you needed to sit probably under the apple tree to get an apple fall on your head to get an insight. I think today, probably the way the whole world is connected, the information overpile that is happening today, that is something that I think many of the companies today are able to master today to get the insights right. So to me today, a connected world is generating tons and tons of information and insights, which I think is leading to new business opportunities today. You could call it as physical, you can call it as phygital, which is physical plus digital. And then you can also call it as digital. I think there are three different spaces that are emerging out. And I'm sure a lot of us in this room today are experiencing this, the whole pace. But when I step back and look at what is it that's happening, I think a connected world generating tons of information, leading to insights, which is actually leading to new business opportunities. And that's across business sectors, if you look at. It's just not about consumer. It's just not about shopping. It is actually spreading across in terms of healthcare, travel, financial inclusions, education. I think the amount of work that we're seeing in education today on the business side, I think tremendous amount of work is happening primarily because of this whole new concept of a connected world. I've seen the power of the connected world closely when I was in telecom as well. And those days it was about connecting the people through voice. But I think the last 5-7 years that we've seen of connection that has happened through data connectivity with the internet ramping up in the last 5 to 7 years after 4G has been predominantly rolled out across the country, and we're talking about 5G today. I think the power that connectivity offers today to businesses, to businessmen, entrepreneurs, to people like us, I think is far, far valuable. And I think that is one thing which excites me when I talk about digital. So I don't look at digital as just a business model, but I think digital today is at the core of what we call as information opportunities and business opportunities. And that is one of the reasons why I thought I'll pick up this discussion with you. And now aligned to this is the fact that if digital is so important today and is evolving today, how does that help us from a business perspective? And how can that be leveraged from business perspective is what I thought I could share over the next maybe 15, 20 minutes as a journey, and then probably link it back to what actions different companies are doing, including Kevin Care. What actions are we seeing in different parts of the country, different industries as well? If you look at today, like I said, there are very clear business models that are emerging. There's a physical business model, which we call as retail. There is a digital business model, which we call as retail plus e-tail. And then there's a completely digital model, which is e-tail, if you were to look at, right? There are different companies straddling across different parts of this whole journey. A company like Kevin Care, for example, has been a hardcore physical-oriented company, distribution-oriented company. Now, we are moving towards a mix of digital, which is a combination of retail and e-tail together. Now, there are companies like Lenskart, which started as pure e-tail companies, but have actually moved to a digital format where they have retail front-end stores, but they also have the core of their business being driven through e-tail as well. And there are pure play companies. Now, there are companies like a brand called Wow, the Wow Shampoo, Wow Skin Sciences, right? And there are many other companies that are pure play digital companies. And we could see that when we, and this space is a space which is very much clearly hotting up today. I'm also part of some of the angel networks when we see a lot of people and a lot of budding entrepreneurs who've been able to use this space very well. Now, Byju's, for example, started as a digital, but probably they're getting into the digital model today. But I think at the core, from a unilateral model of being a physical model, we've been able to actually, and I mean, at the early stages, probably the only e-tail probably sort of model was Yahoo, when Yahoo started out with Yahoo Mail. But I think today, if you were to look at, I think all the three business models are quite clearly emerging. And each of them have very clear opportunities and scales that are emerging today. And of course, it's news. It's nothing known. All of us look at this. I'm sure all of us would also be wanting to be a part of this. We're seeing a flurry of unicorns. We're seeing a flurry of companies that are probably making it up. Now, some of these could be on valuation, but I think if you were to really look at, some of the companies are actually redefining the spaces that they operate on. And that's primarily based on the digital understanding and the digital opportunity seizing that they're able to do. And of course, in the space that I've been, we've seen a lot of brands that have been able to scale up much, much quickly and faster. Typically, retail brands take around X years. I mean, you could call it 3 years, 5 years. Typically, retail brands take around X years for the first 100 crores of turnover. We've seen a lot of e-tail only brands being able to actually do those turnovers in half the time and scale up. Now, it's another fact that probably after the first 100, 200 crores of turnover, they're not able to scale up faster and they go back to the old economy companies to be probably a strategic tie-up or be taken over. But I think the core is in this world of digital today, a lot of new brands are able to quickly scale up, launch, scale up, and quickly be able to reach milestones that probably would have taken a lot more years in the physical space today. The other one that we see is clearly data is actually a big competitive edge. And why would I say so? It has always been so in any business. In any business, data is actually the core of the business. Consumer insight is what drives the entire business. It could be a B2B business. It could be a B2C business. Unless we understand the consumer right and get the insight right, the business does not flourish. But with the digital era today, I think a lot of companies have been able to leverage this data as a big competitive edge. And that's because I think the ability to generate insights, which is then translated to strategy and then clearly executed very well. I think this is one of the spaces that I'm quite clearly looking at when we look at some of the companies. So far, if you were to look at, I think the digital space is enabling a lot of new opportunities to come in on the back of multiple business categories that are opening up, new business models that are opening up, ability to scale up brands, and of course, on the back of a very powerful insight-led business model. One of the things I firmly believe that differentiates an entrepreneur from a professional is very clearly the capability to actually be able to sharpshoot on a particular insight. And when you sharpshoot on that insight and put your conviction behind that insight, that is when a product is born. I think what digital does to us today is it enables even a professional like me to be able to actually get a lot more insights very sharply defined, neatly arranged, and then the power of that knowledge translates to strategies and therefore into a execution excellence. I've seen a lot of companies, including KevinCare, deploy that very clearly in the last few years. And of course, one of the things that I see very clearly today is geography's history, right? When I say geography's history, we see a lot of brands today which are not only Tamil Nadu based or which are not only Maharashtra based. My favorite example of late is a brand called Postcard. The proposition of the brand is that it manages to actually get you any product across the country. It's a snacks product, but it gets you products from anywhere in the country. So sitting in Chennai, I could get actually an Indori save, or I could get a sort of a Lucknowi delicacy. I can get something from Jammu Kashmir. I could get something from Maharashtra. In fact, at one stroke, I was able to actually order a palette of almost 15 different delicacies. Now, this is not something that I could have seen in the physical world before. Yes, possible if you had multiple physical stores available, but in general, I think it was not a sort of a physical formatting that was possible, which I think today is being made possible. It is about actually consumers able to understand your product, appreciate your product, and then you can actually, so we've got some of our products. And for example, we've got some of our shampoos, which we thought were hardcore Tamil Nadu based shampoos from a brand perspective. But off late, we're seeing a lot of those brands getting picked up by people in Lucknow, people in Kanpur, people in Bihar, on the basis of the ingredient or on the basis of the proposition that the brand offers. I think to me, therefore, in a way, geography is history, which means the business expanse that we are probably attacking as a business today is far, far higher. The globe, in fact, I would say the entire world is in your hands if you have the right proposition with you. So it is not about being limited to a Chennai or limited to a Tamil Nadu or a Bangalore, but the appetite to be going global, I think, is far, far higher today with this whole digital space that is opening up today. Therefore, in my mind, digital to me is a much bigger opportunity that faces all of us. While we keep thinking about ideas, keep thinking about it, I think it's also important for us to say, how do we leverage this as a big, big opportunity? And the reason I'm saying this is, while a lot of us in this group are starting off and probably are in a better place, therefore, to be able to appreciate it, if you were to look at old economy companies, a lot of erstwhile successful companies, probably the adaptation cycle for some of these companies is far lower today, right? And the reason for that is, I think, being able to appreciate this, being able to take this as an opportunity and move while continuing to retain the older aspects of learning is a big opportunity come weakness. Learning is a big part of this digital journey today. And I'm sure all of us here in this room today, that is one thing that I would urge upon. The learning that we need to do in this space is far, far higher. And I think that's what keeps me excited. And that's what I think is a big opportunity that probably would lead to a lot of people like you being able to make far more big successes out of it in your own businesses. So how do we leverage digital? See, if I were to simply put, while all of this is fine, at a business level, nothing has changed in my mind. The core of the business has not changed. I think the way the consumer experiences the business has changed, but the core of the business has not changed. If I were to ask a few questions, which I'm sure all of us ask, who do I want to sell it to? That's the consumer. That has not changed. Whether you're digital or physical, you still need to know which consumer do you want to sell your product to. Is it a B2C product? Is it a B2B product? Second, I think, is what do you want to sell? What is the product? Now, the product is what we are all selling to consumers, right? What is that product? That does not change. Why do you want the consumer to buy you? That's the brand. Why would you want the brand? Why would you want the consumer to buy you? That's your brand. Any business, physical, digital, I think this core does not change, right? This core remains the same irrespective of what form of business model you want, because this is the core of what we think is consumer today. And this is the core of what we think is success in the industry today. However, what is changing is this. Digital has actually brought in a very big change in two big things that I would say, how to sell and where to sell. If I were to simplify this entire game, as a businessman, as a person involved in business, this I think is why I am more interested in learning digital and exploiting digital. It has expanded my horizon. It has expanded the horizons of opportunity available for all of us. It is also actually changing the way you have to sell to consumers and where to sell to consumers, because consumers are actually moving in this direction today. A lot of consumers today, many of the businesses that you look at today, there are a set of businesses that would say maybe 5-6% of my business comes from e-commerce / digital, right? There are on the other spectrum, there are companies which say 100% of my business comes from digital. Both the companies exist today. There are companies which have 100% of the businesses from digital formats. There are companies which have 5-7%. But at the end of the day, I think all businesses are moving towards digital because consumers moving towards digital. I think the same consumer who was shopping before in, say, a supermarket or a Kirana store today, they are slowly migrating towards the digital format. And hence, therefore, I think at the end of the day, it is important for any successful brand to be equally present in the digital format. And for any new brand, ignoring the digital format is at its own peril, because I think the growth levers are far more sharper in each of these formats. Therefore, if I have to look at the consumer experience and the journey is actually getting differentiated in the digital world. And with each step, the marketeer is actually getting strengthened by the data and the feedback that we get. For today, for example, some of our product launches, we are able to actually, while a typical product launch takes us 8 to 10 months, sometimes even 18 months for us, we are seeing today that we're able to actually launch small scale products, maybe in 3 months' time, start to finish. And by the end of the 6th month, we are able to actually get feedback as to how the product is working. Now, this is where I think it's a very big difference that comes to you. Even if you don't want to play the digital game, but you want to play the physical game, the digital space offers you a very good mechanism to be able to get first-hand feedback from the consumers. A lot of our products today, while it takes a lot of time for us to be able to physically get reviews from consumers, talk to them, which is what the old models that we were doing, today, once I launch a product, by the 45th day or the 60th day, I'm actually able to get a very significant review and a very forthright review of what my product is or what my brand is. What it does to me is it helps us actually therefore recalibrate our approach. By recalibrating our approach, I mean whether the consumers are liking it, whether our understanding of what the consumers wanted is right. Now, this is equally true in the B2B space as well. Whether it's B2B or B2C, I think this space is offering us tremendous amount of information, which is what I went back to the original slide. A connected world is giving me a lot of information and insights, which when deployed well, is actually helping me drive our businesses better. To me, therefore, I think one of the critical things is present in digital, understanding digital, leveraging digital, and as a marketeer, as an entrepreneur, also understanding how to actually market your products in the digital medium. I would say digital marketing today is therefore a science. It's not an art. It's not an art anymore. It's a science that is getting well oiled today. It's a science that there is a step-by-step manual that is available. There are people who are able to help you navigate the space and say, okay, when you launch a brand, how do you launch them? Who do you partner with? That's the channel side of it. From a consumer perspective, very clearly, there are 5 big steps that we're seeing. The discovery process, creating the interest for the consumer, how does the consumer order your product vis-a-vis what we used to before see as how does the consumer pick your product. Here it's about ordering. How does the consumer receive your product? Do the consumers receive it on time? Do they receive it in a, unlike a supermarket scenario where a consumer just picks up the product and leaves the supermarket, here it is a huge logistics effort involved in actually getting a product reaching out to consumers in the right shape and form. How do they receive it? How do they use it? And what's the review that you get? I'm finally getting the repeat of the same consumer again. This entire journey, I think, is a marketeer's domain. And this is what for a long time we've been doing. But I think what is happening today is with digital, it's becoming far, far sharper and far, far clearer. Our ability, therefore, to be able to influence some of these spaces are becoming far more important, right? Now, discovery, for example, I'm sure a lot of us have this experience. When I wanted to buy my television, I didn't go to the Sony showroom first. What I did was to go to the internet and check a huge amount of reviews, check what's happening in different parts. What is the review ratings for this product? Now, this I'm doing it for a 1 lakh, 2 lakh type of a product. Even for a high engagement product, a high value product, an experiential product, before you go to experience the product, you just want to be double sure that, are we actually getting the right review for the product? So the consumer behavior today, the discovery of the product is not starting only at the physical channel. It's actually moved to the digital channel. So you may be selling fans. You may be selling a product which is a B2B product. But at the end of the day, if the review about that product is not good on the net, it is influencing some consumer's discoverability at some point of time. So I think this whole process, therefore, of leveraging this whole digital space, both for business opportunities and for marketing opportunities, I think is quite important today. If you were to look at from a ordering perspective, the reason I called it order is because I think one of the things that's very clear in this space is till the buy button is placed. Now, nowadays, even the buy button does not matter. Till the buy button is pressed, you don't have the order in your hand. Because suddenly, probably something else might pop up, which actually has a much better proposition than what you're offering. And in a jiffy, the product is gone or the sale is gone, right? So effectively, this space is far more competitive. This space is fought on the basis of instant response. This space is fought on the basis of a very quick cycle of data analysis as well. It's run as a science. And I think that is probably where a lot more learning can come for us. And my experience has been, my experience at Kevin Care, my experience with my colleagues in the different parts of the industry has been very clearly, we need to master this subject as a science, small or big. I think it's important that this is mastered. And I did present a chart where I said some of the new brands are able to scale up in half the time as some of the older economy brands. And the key reason for that in my mind is this. These new brands and new companies have been able to understand digital marketing far, far more sharply than what probably old economy companies have been able to understand. And therefore, to my mind, I think digital marketing is becoming a very important part of the whole game plan that we have. A lot of case studies, a lot of things that we can share, and I can share it during the interaction. I think it's a lot of case studies that are evolving today to help us understand. And if there was one area that I would invest disproportionately my time as a leader and my organization's time and efforts would be in this space. Now, we belong to a space where maybe 5 to 7% of our revenues today are coming from digital. We would like it to go to 25%. Now, there are companies which probably have a similar way, and there are some entrepreneurs who would like to scale it up as well. I think the way I would look at it is, amongst many other things, I think this is one area probably that needs disproportionate investment. Even before a disproportionate investment, I think at the leadership level, at the topmost level, we should learn it. We should learn this art, because this is what probably would also be driving some of the future growths. As much as we understand product, I'm sure as entrepreneurs, we understand a product, we are very close to a product, right? We're very close to our product, our propositions. We also need to understand this space far more importantly. And second, this space is not going to be taught to you by people like me, or probably people like, if I may take the liberty, even EVMR, right? This area is going to be taught to you by millennials. This area is going to be taught to you by young people who are actually able to understand this space far more better than we would understand today. So one of the things that we've done in our organization today, we've done two things very specifically. One thing is that this entire journey has been split into a startup. We have a startup within our own organization that behaves like a typical startup. And I'm sure as a part of that, I'm entitled to be a part of the TIE membership as well. The other part of it is this startup is purely run by people, young people off the college, 3 to 4 years of experience, having a very different view of consumption, right? Because the core audience here are very different from the older audience. The second is this entire journey is actually being learned by them. And I can very clearly say, if it took me 9 to 12 months to understand this space, a youngster probably took at least max of 3 to 4 months. So the learning curve is also much faster with the millennials. The learning curve is much faster with the youngsters. I'm sure a lot of youngsters are here. I think the learning curve is faster there. Therefore, as an organization, it is important that we have the right set of people who understand this space and become trainers, become masters, who can actually translate that learning across the organization as a culture. This, when combined with innovation, product innovation or technology innovation, this is what makes a very strong new economy company, I would say. And companies that master this, in my mind, are the true unicorns. I mean, no marketing chart is complete without having some chart like this. Pardon me if it's a little too broad, but I think I wanted to just simplify it to say, where does this all lead to, right? Digital is fine. What does it lead to? I think there are 8 spaces that I would like to focus on, especially when I look at it from a digital space. What are the consumer choices? What choices is the consumer making today? I think that is becoming a very critical determining point today from a digital marketing perspective. Digital marketing, if I were to say, is very clearly about choices that the consumer is making. Earlier, these choices were not available to the consumer, because when the consumer went to a particular place, it depended on what product was available on the shelf. But today, if you were to look at, almost every brand is available in the digital space on the mobile phone, on the internet, on your laptop. So the availability of choices is plenty today for the consumer. The second big thing I would see is commerce. The way the consumer shopping today is changing, not just from a shopping perspective, the way they are paying the money, the way they are transacting, the loyalty points. I think there's a huge space available there. Third thing that I would very clearly see is digital is leading to customization. Today, many companies are in a space where they can provide you a customized pack. Cadbury's did that exercise. Kevin Cadd did that exercise. We can offer to you a shampoo that is customized to you in the way you want it to be for your particular problem. And that's possible today. And I'm sure we would at some point have to come out with that innovation. Ability to understand a consumer at a n is equal to 1 level and be able to translate that into a product proposition. Right now, Cadbury's are a good campaign that they did, where they were able to actually customize it to the retailers in the beat. A lot of tech companies have been able to do this. So customization, I think, is becoming one big area that I would see. Communication, of course, is becoming very different. Your normal television campaign, your press ads, they may or may not work in the digital space. You need communication which is very sharp. One of the things that's happening with consumers today, the attention span of consumers today is very short. They're not sitting to look at 5 minute, 10 minutes sort of. Of course, they spend a lot of time looking at content, but when it comes to communication, when it comes to ads, the attention span of consumers is becoming very difficult because they have many other things to do. You're fighting for their share of what I would call as eyesight. Share of eyesight in my mind is, if the consumer is spending 24 hours, if the consumer has got, say, 16 hours in a day, assuming 8 hours they sleep, which I don't think most consumers do today, half of the 8 hours is being spent on the content today. But I think if you look at how much of time the consumer has, we are fighting for every minute. Brands are fighting for it. Multiple categories are fighting for it. In that space, the communication needs to be far more quick, crisp, to the point. The other word that I would say is content. Content definitely is being, is becoming a big, big area of change today from a digital space. And the reason we need to understand this is some of this can be leveraged to a digital marketeer's benefit. Content today is actually becoming a big lever that is available to segment consumers. A lot of our segmentation today of consumers is also happening on the basis of content that is being consumed, psychographic, not Tamil versus Telugu versus Hindi, not just that alone. What type of content are you watching? How frequently do you watch that content? Hence, therefore, what sort of communication appeals to you? And therefore, can I provide you at the right time? So in a way, content, if leveraged well, is giving me segmentation insights. And that's something that I probably can use. The other one is clusterization, which is what I explained to you about geography's history. Today, consumers are not getting clustered by physical boundaries of states or geographies or countries. They're getting clustered by their consumption patterns. And the data available for consumption patterns today. So when we wanted to run for one of our shampoos, we wanted to understand a particular ingredient. Is it only available? Is it to be only sold in, say, a Tamil Nadu? And we did a little bit of analytics around it. To our surprise, we found that there are clusters that are willing to look at it in a Lucknow. There are clusters willing to look at it in Bihar. There are clusters willing to look at it in Gujarat. Now, in the erstwhile scenario, I couldn't have imagined about this. I wouldn't have been able to create a product that is actually available for a few clusters. Today, we don't cluster our consumers on the basis of only geographies. We look at linguistic preferences. We look at cultural preferences. We look at consumption preferences. We also look at content preferences. So I think over a period of time, clusterization is becoming important. And one of the famous statements that I would always go back, India is never a country of states. It's not a country of 29 states. Actually, India is about maybe 14 to 15 clusters. Clusters defined by linguistic preferences, consumption preferences, right? The other one is, of course, the channel. The channels are very different today. You have a cosmetics channel. You have a channel which specializes on agri products. You have a channel which specializes on content. There's a whole lot of channel that is available to sell. Where to sell is actually a choice that we need to make very clearly. And of course, the cost to market. My ability to experiment today is very, very high. I don't need to have if I were to launch a product erstwhile, I had to pick up a full Chennai or do it, or I have to pick up a full Tamil Nadu to do it. Today, I don't need to do it. The scale available to me to experiment is far, far higher. And I think the cost to market, therefore, is coming down. Our chairman's favorite statement, which is a culture that we're building today, is fail fast, fail cheap. Ability to be able to experiment, no doubt we may fail. When you do 100 experiments, you may fail 90 times, no problem. As long as you fail fast and fail cheap. Why fail fast? Because you don't lose time. Why fail cheap? Because you can actually reinvest back into multiple attempts. So fail fast, fail cheap. And I think this philosophy is well captured in the digital space today, if I may do. So I look at it as 8 spaces that are important from a digital perspective for anybody who wants to look at it from the lens of a marketeer, right? So summing up in my mind, I would say digital is a much, much bigger opportunity. In the order of priority, I would say, learn this, leverage the learning, and then leap forward. And I think I'm sure a lot of us would be looking in this direction or already involved in this. It's about getting a lot more knowledge around this, being able to leverage that knowledge, and then being able to leap forward. And I think this needs, at the end of the day, this needs a very clear strategy. The strategy that is actually supported by a structure. And the structure that enables you to be able to understand these processes better, which means in the structure that I would prescribe, you need to have a lot of youngsters who understand the space. That enables you to actually quickly understand the process and put up a process and the right set of people. So in my mind, if you had asked me, digital is a big opportunity, take the leap, create the strategy, follow it up with a good structure, leverage it with good people in your teams, and therefore be able to then put processes in place. At the end of the day, it's a science. To me, business beyond being an art today is actually becoming a science. And I think that is where probably I would leave it with. So to me, therefore, summing up, digital is a much, much bigger opportunity. Let's look forward to how each one of us can leverage this to our benefit, to the benefit of the country. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I request Mr. Srinivas to take over the conversation. And is there
thanks,
any question?
Thanks, Venki. Are you able to hear me?
Yeah, you're able to hear me.
Yeah. Thanks, Venki. That was quite an enlightening session. It was great hearing your views. Venki, you're also able to hear me, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So actually, one thing that I found very interesting is you spoke about the short launch cycle, where you said, you know, earlier it used to be many months, now 3 months. Any examples of it, either from Kevin Care or from your investing as an investor, which are the most striking examples that can inspire the team?
So I think from Kevin Care, we've got a lot of portfolios that we built. So for example, the whole hygiene portfolio that we had, right? One was, of course, the topical opportunity that it provided. But our hygiene products were all being able to launch in a much quicker time. And that's primarily from a perspective where the ability to shorten it is coming in from the insights that we are getting. See, earlier what used to happen, and I think that's linked to the digital space. Earlier what used to happen is, when we need to launch a product, you need to, of course, go to consumers, talk to consumers, get insights, validate your insights with consumers and come back. This whole space takes a long time when it's done physically. Now, with the likes of Facebook and with the likes of the digitally connected world today, this is getting shortened today because there are clusters of consumers whom you're able to reach out in a much faster manner, talk to them, and they're willing to talk to you. It's not that they don't want to talk to you, they talk to you. When you do that, the cycle gets shortened automatically in terms of the inciting process and validating the hypothesis. Once this is done, the production prototypes and the other ones are far more easier to do because that is within our own control. And I think over a period of time, we've also created prototypes or we've created prototype models where you don't need to go for large factory setups. Within our companies, we have small scale units that we have set up to be able to launch small quantities, so that you can actually quickly go. So two things that I would say. One is very clearly, we've been able to reach consumers far quickly by way of the digital media. Second, I think is we've been able to actually ensure that our production processes are also streamlined and capable of handling small scale. A combination of these two is helping us launch products quickly. And the third, of course, what I mentioned to you, once the product is launched, the feedback is instant. The first consumer who picks up the product and gives you the feedback, I think the feedback just follows after that. So I think this is a cycle that we follow, and I've seen a very typical example that I would say is the hygiene products that we launched last year and a couple of other projects that we have launched in our e-commerce space. We have a couple of e-commerce specific SKUs that we've launched. These SKUs have come in record time.
So when you say e-commerce specific SKUs, these are normally sold in Amazon, or is it that you're also piloting some digital at Kevin Care? I mean, are you setting up your own portal?
Yeah. So I think that's another space that we have today. Large part of it is through partners. But of late, I'm seeing, including Kevin Care, I'm seeing the belief in going on your own is also further increasing depending on the categories we are present in. Because I think some of the spaces potentially offer opportunities to go on our own. We, of course, we have piloted our own D2C channel, a direct-to-consumer channel. But my belief is, I think it would be a smaller part of the larger pie. For reasonable years to come, the ecosystem is going to be supporting us as partners. They also help us launch new products. equally, we also have created a space where we want to learn. The direct-to-consumer channel is more from a learning perspective than from a commercial perspective. Because the direct-to-consumer channel also helps us understand consumer feedback faster. To this group, I think I can be transparent. One of the things that you have a disadvantage with some of the partners is because you don't get the consumer insight. The consumer insight is with the partner. It does not or necessarily get shared with you. Whereas when you go direct, the consumer insight is available. So I would, if there is a business model that enables me to go direct to consumer, I would invest in that model for the simple reason that I get more insights back to me faster.
Yeah, good to hear that. Well, one more question I had was, see, traditionally, a lot of small businessmen have actually been in the distributor space at various levels. Right? They'll be shopkeepers, they'll be traders, or they'll be wholesalers, distributors. What you spoke about, this disruption in the channel, are you seeing a kind of a tsunami happening there? Are certain people going out of business? Are new business opportunities coming up? So what is this whole, what is happening in the channel?
So yeah, I think that's in a way, India, I think, is a land of opportunity, I would say. While there is a certain shift that is happening towards this whole e-commerce led space, another area of impact of digital, which I didn't capture, is of course the whole modernization that's happening of the traditional channel today. Right? One of the things that's also equally in parallel happening is that some of the traditional channels, when I say traditional channels, the retail part of it, they are getting digitized heavily today from two perspectives. One perspective is it's helping them control their inventories better, and therefore they're getting onto the bandwagon of digitization. Second is, I think a lot of companies are also creating a system where the last mile delivery is actually done through the Kirana stores today or the traditional channel. So in a way, if you were to look at, I would see it's a healthy combination of the two that would happen in the future. Kirana stores will continue to exist. They're not going away. In my mind, traditional channel will not go away. I think India is a land of opportunities with multiple consumer segments today. You can look at it as multiple consumer clusters. Rural, for example, is completely isolated from this e-commerce space today, but it's growing very well. So that's a very traditional channel which continues to be traditional. Inroads of e-commerce will happen into rural over the next few years. But if somebody were to be focusing on rural, I think the digital impact of rural is far more from connectivity perspective and logistics perspective than from a marketplace perspective. But I think the impact on technology or the impact of technology in rural is very heavy. If you were to look at the urban part, some of the biggest cities are seeing this transformation. But I think equally what the pandemic has also taught us is that there is an equally parallel system that continues to exist. Especially during the pandemic, we saw the Kirana stores were completely on the front foot. And my view, personal view, and I've been endorsing this view, they are going to stay. It's a question of equipping them better. The portfolio of products that a Kirana store sells and a portfolio of product that the e-commerce channel sells could be different. And therefore, to that extent, I think it would be there. Right? And I think that's the way I would see. In my household, for example, if I were to take as a panel, in my household, while a lot of shopping is happening through e-commerce, my neighborhood supermarket consumption has not reduced. I would say it's only added up. So to me, I think it's a parallel string that happens. Of course, I think they're also getting tech savvy, their ordering process, their replenishment, their inventory management. And therefore, I think they're also becoming far more tech savvy is what I would say. It, of course, puts a little bit of pressure on the traditional distributors, traditional businessmen who are not willing to be able to change. That is a problem. But I think if people are willing to learn, this is an opportunity that is there with everybody today.
Thanks, Erin. That's good to hear. Just a last question from my side, maybe before we go to the open house. More as an investor, like you're saying, you have an amazing perspective as an angel investor. So what are the sectors that excite you? What are the sectors you don't get into? What is your advice? You know, if there is an entrepreneur wanting to start something but doesn't know what to start, what kind of areas would you guide him to explore?
See, I think that's a very pretty interesting space. And I think the reason why I'm quite excited about that is it helps me understand some of the new opportunities that are getting evolved in the system today. And so it's not purely financial, but I think more from a perspective, if I were to look at the opportunities that are opening up is huge, right? And I think that's being led by the whole space of new age setups that are happening. If I were to look at what excites me in terms of space, or if I were to look at in terms of what spaces are hottening up, I think there is one fundamental principle that I believe for a country like India. India as a country has got so much of opportunities from consumer perspective. At the end of the day, it's a 1.3 billion, 130 crore population, right? That 130 crore population, give or take different segment cuts that we do, is a sizable population that's consuming today, even in rural. So I think, and as we get back to our economy steps, I think that's only going to increase. To me, one thing that I would probably see is if there is a proposition that we believe can be scaled up to a larger segment, but we start small, that's an area that probably every entrepreneur should attempt. We may not be able to solve the problem for 130 crore Indians, but if the problem is universal and we have a solution to it, even if it starts in the corner of the world, I think that's a very big proposition that we could see, right? And many companies have proved it in the past as well. So one space that I would look at is, what sort of a problem that I'm solving? Is it an universal problem, which is universal to the Indian economy, that can be actually replicated? And even if 10 other people were to replicate that solution, I still have a chance to win. I think that's one space that I'm very clearly looking at. The second space that I'm looking at is, given the fact that as a country, we are bound to grow, then in the next decade, whatever has happened in the past decade, part of the pandemic, part of policy decisions, the next decade, or if the next 15 years you have to see, I think are going to be the golden years of the country. It is going to be led by consumption. It is going to be led by technology. It is going to be led by a lot of opportunities that come in. And therefore, I think consumption is a space that I would probably be interested in leveraging it as we move. Different forms of consumption, right? The third, I think, is if there is an opportunity that can be leveraged to define the infrastructure. And some of the spaces are getting defined by infrastructure opportunities that we have, right? Those are spaces that I would look at. So if I were to look at, I would look at scale. I don't need to attempt to reach the entire scale, but if I'm part of a problem that is scalable, I think that's a solution that's scalable. I think that's one opportunity. If I'm part of the consumer space, which is evolving today far sharply, if I'm part of the consumer space that is growing, that's the second space I'd look at. The third space that I would look at is in terms of saying that the tech space, because tech is actually solving a lot of problems for people, whether it's on analytics, whether it's on deep machine learning, artificial intelligence, the tech space is another space that is actually evolving much sharper. So the tech space is the other space that I would like. I broadly look at these three themes, right? And I think for anybody to be invested today, or anybody who strikes the right business model today, I think the next 15 years, I would believe, is golden years for the country.
Thanks, Venkat. That's quite nice to hear that. I saw a couple of people raising their hands. I think Jawahar. Priya, do you want to open up the floor for questions? You might have to unmute the...
Good evening, sir. This is Jawahar from Coimbatore. Are you able to hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, sir. My question is, you spoke about this, 130 crore people and the opportunity for us to expand in Indian market. But the reality is, more than half of Indian population don't have access to internet. And, the digital penetration in India is like very less compared to countries like United States and European countries. So, your products, Kevin Care products, especially, you make things like shampoo, where, even the rural population is using it, even people who do not know how to use a smartphone or don't have access to internet buy your products. So how do you address this problem of not having digital penetration in the areas? How do you expand your market? What kind of, strategy you do to expand your market in rural areas where there is no digital penetration?
So if you were to look at today, let me be specific on the FMCG industry and then probably the other industries as well. Okay. Most of the industries today, if you were to look at, rural is actually growing far, far faster than urban. And this has been the scenario for the last 3 to 4 years, primarily on two reasons. One reason is about the way the rural economy is shaping up. There are challenges, there are larger structural challenges that we have. But if you look at it from a consumption perspective, the rural market consumption is actually shaping up far more sharply today than it has been in the past. If you look at FMCG industry in particular, the last 3-4 years, I would say the last 5 years, the growth of the rural industry has been far more sharper than the growth of the urban markets. So at a consumption level, I think the rural markets offer us plenty of opportunities to be able to leverage as businessmen. There are structural challenges in a specific set of areas, which I think is probably something that we can't influence, but I think that at a much larger policy level needs to be influenced. However, at a consumption level, I think the growth is robust and it continues to be robust. In fact, it has come to a level where today, if rural does not fire, some of the companies would be under trouble. So to that extent, I think it is a journey that is evolving today. And we at Kevin Care, for example, have a very clear focus on rural as an independent consumer segment, increasing our reach to rural markets, physical reach to rural markets. And like you said, that's because I think the influence of digital today is still not 100% on to that market. However, physically reaching those markets and providing them with the right set of propositions, I think is a big agenda that we are driving and every business wants to drive. The second part of the discussion is, despite all these challenges, the aspirations of the rural market is quite high. So you could see that in some categories like garments. You could see that in some categories where even when you look at Amazon type of marketplaces, a lot of consumers are actually now buying products from the e-commerce sites. They may not be buying your regular products, but they're actually buying some of the aspirational products. Garments, for example, is a very big segment that is seeing quite a full traction on e-commerce today. One of the reasons, therefore, is that a lot of the e-commerce players want to set up physical infrastructure to leverage this demand curve by actually being closer to the consumer and supply it. So the in my mind, over a period of time, the issue is not going to be about consumer or consumer aspiration. The issue is going to be about the logistics capability of players to be able to service that particular demand. Today it's being physically done. Tomorrow we might need to have an alternate model to do it. But closer to the consumer is something that every company wants to be, including the e-commerce companies. The other big thing I firmly believe is if you look at today from a 4G perspective, and the reason I'm spending time on this is today, 95% of the country today is connected by 4G, right? And I've been a part of the system that was rolling this out 4-5 years ago. Today, the country is connected far more sharply by mobile internet. They may not be connected by broadband, but they're connected by mobile internet, which is equally big as what probably you would see in a country like a US or in a country like China. What is following this network today is the adoption of smartphones as we move forward. That adoption is going to happen. So one of the events that I believe is a big event that can happen that can redefine rural is when the penetration of smartphones in rural starts increasing. Today, probably out of the 500 million consumers that we have in rural, 200 million are smartphones, 300 million are still not smartphones yet. And the 200 million smartphones are being used by youngsters in the rural market. They're not being used by the wage earners or by the key people in the family. It's the youngsters who are using it. The day the economy prospers for the family to be start able to get the smartphones in their hands, that also becomes a very defining moment. So I would lay a big bet in rural, saying in the next couple of years, as the 4G network starts stabilizing across the country, as mobile internet starts penetrating, as smartphones become more affordable, you would see a very different behavior emerging out of small towns and rural markets. And that is when probably some of the magic that you see happening today in urban markets will happen in the rural markets. Till then, It is about we physically reaching the rural markets and catering to the demand. I'm quite bullish about this whole space, despite the structural challenges that we have today as a country. But I think on the consumption side, I think there are very clear indicators that this is a big opportunity that we have. Yeah. I hope I answered your question.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have Jayashree.
Yeah, hi. The question I have is around building brand loyalty over the digital platform. Because one thing you find is in many of the e-commerce platforms, they while you may have loyalty to the platform itself, people don't stay loyal to a product within or a brand within, say, Amazon or Flipkart. So how do you exactly build this brand loyalty over the digital space?
So I think this is done in two forms. And I think that's a challenge that all of us face. First and foremost, I think it is the there are two, three areas that can help us from that perspective. Once, if you are a first mover in that space, the residual loyalty that you get is far, far higher. And that is not shaken too much by the preferences that the channel is able to shape. So one of the things that is very clear in this space is you cannot be a me too. We need to be an innovator and a first mover in the space that we operate. I think that's one important thing as far as brands are concerned, especially in the consumer space. Innovation is very particularly important and scalable because replication is far easier today. And the cost of entry today with these channels is very easy. So to that extent, I would say if the brand is based on innovation or if the brand is based on a unique proposition, it takes time for competition to catch up. And that is one window of opportunity that is available for us to establish a brand very clearly. The second attempt that makes is where it is important, therefore, to be able to create a connect with the consumer outside the platform. When I say outside the platform, it is about building communities, right? One of the things that we've seen many successful brands do in the e-commerce space, while they are present essentially in the channel, and they manage the channel dynamics very well. One of the areas that is important is that we need to be able to create our own connect with the consumers. Now, two, three ways in which companies are attempting it. One attempt is to go directly to the consumer by establishing our own websites. Now, that's a very costly exercise, but of course, that's something that we need to invest upon as we move. The second, what we do is to build communities. See, when I say communities, which is what I called as clusterization, one of the digital manifestations of clusterization is to build communities. For example, one of our brands, we have very clearly moms as a target segment. Now, I can do that in the e-commerce space, but we're also looking at building a very strong community with moms and the brand connect with moms. Now, that is where probably the brand is able to withstand the pressure of what probably the other competition could do, but it has its own standing with its core consumers. So I think going direct is one opportunity. First of all, be innovative, be the leader, be the first mover. I think that's a very critical part of e-commerce. You can't be a me too. In the physical world, me toos were possible because the brand was not omnipresent. And therefore, me toos were always possible. You could probably be strong in Tamil Nadu, whereas somebody could be same proposition, somebody could be strong in a Maharashtra. But in today's e-commerce world, that's not feasible because the moment your product is available and successful, somebody in a Timbuktu can launch that product and have it sold to a person in Chennai. So to that extent, I think be the innovator, be differentiated, be the first mover. I think that's very critical to the brand. Second is the brand language and the brand connect has to be to the core audience very sharply defined and build your own space of communities. Build your own space of communities and connect with consumers. So while the completion of the sale can happen with the e-commerce platforms, and tomorrow it could be direct to consumer, have a big brand connect. So I think the other C that I would always say is connecting with the consumers far more important. That is what I think a lot of brands today are realizing. And there are brands which have actually taken a call saying, I won't be in these e-commerce platforms, but I build my own. Nike as a brand is a very good example, but they are far powerful brand. So what that explains to us is if the brand has a connect with the consumer, I think it's far more easier for us to be able to do that. It's a question of time and it's a question of energy and investment to be put behind.
Thank you, sir. Is there any questions? Please feel free to click on the hand raise or put your questions on the chat. Even if it's in Tamil. Okay, Mr. Nandakumar has put a chat. It's just a, he wants you to share the details about the product and mom sure. community you spoke about.
I'll do that offline. We can do that.
Yeah. Anyone with any questions?
So, Venki, just one question. See, one of the things you said is that a lot of startups tend to plateau at around 100 crore turnover, that kind of scale. How do you feel it will play out? Is it going to be a lot of companies? Because there seems to be a lot of these startups in that 0 to 100. So is that something big companies are worried about, or is it that they're just using it as a lab to kind of incubate and take over whatever is successful? So it seems to be a very recent phenomenon, this 0 to 100 crores.
Yeah. What's essentially happening, I think, is the, I think there are two parts to this whole game. A lot of entrepreneurs are able to come with brilliant ideas and brilliant product propositions that are very innovative. And because it's easy to enter into the market and the cost of entry is relatively lower today, a lot of experimentation happens and scale-up is happening. And to that extent, I think the accelerator from 0 to 100 is very fast and they're able to go through. However, what is happening is, as you start scaling up, which is why I called it as a science, as we start scaling up, the science of scaling up is probably getting lost on the smaller startups. Now, it could be primarily because they have not planned their finances properly. It could be probably they're burning the money far too fast. It could be possibly that they have not planned the runway. One of the things that I believe is it's important to actually plan your runway. Even if you have a good business proposition with you, planning a runway is important because I think the scale-up needs effort, scale-up needs patience, scale-up needs proper planning. So what I see in most of the organizations is the good thing about startups is they're very nimble, they're very agile. They're actually able to quickly come up with solutions that probably, based on insights, that probably older economy companies are struggling to find today by way of the hierarchy or the weightiness of the existing system. And they're able to quickly launch it into the market and scale it up. And of course, because of the scale-up opportunities available and the support systems available today, they're able to actually convert a proof of concept into a faster business model. However, when the rubber hits the road, if you don't plan it properly, if you're not able to get your finances right, your sequencing of program right, I think we're missing it out. And that's the signs that most of the startups are actually missing out. And that's the signs that probably the older economy companies have mastered. So to me, it's a marriage of convenience that is happening today. I wouldn't say it's good or bad, but I think it's a marriage of convenience that is happening today where older economy companies are figuring it out that if this is a problem statement that new economy companies are facing, is it a convenience of marriage and can we bring together? I think that's the way to do it. The other way that people like us are trying, we are trying to actually therefore understand this problem and say, listen, problem lies within us. And therefore being an entrepreneur-led company, why wouldn't I not be? Kevin Care, for example, was a startup 30 years ago. We continue to believe we need to be a startup even today, in spite of the size that might be we have. So equally what we've done therefore is we've cleaved out a startup separately. And this startup behaves like a typical startup, right? And many companies are trying this. They're trying the accelerator mode, incubating companies within their own company buying out companies and scaling them up, this is happening. But for an entrepreneur who believes or if he wants to leave a legacy, it's important that you plan your journey. It's not important to be excited about the top line. I think it's about planning your journey and leveraging that journey. Don't burn yourself too fast. And I think I can say, and what I've seen with different investing companies that I've seen, sometimes the founders have actually opened up too fast. I think that is probably where it leads to the problems like this.
Ela, lot of wisdom in words. I think a lot of questions are coming up on digital marketing, I think.
So,
before we take the questions on chat, we have Sailesh Kumar who would like to ask you a question.
Hi, sir. My name is Sailesh. So, my question is that, you know, when coming to e-commerce space, definitely, you know, in retail, they can able to see the conversion, you know, in by their own, you know, hand, right? But in digital commerce, like the traction will happen, it will take some time, right? What kind of timeline will it take for, you know, for an ROI, or how much should everyone invest in an digital commerce space? You know, is there any percentage to that? Or how do we see that?
See, I think, like I said, it's an evolving space today. It's a lot of experimentation that we need to do in this space. At the same time, like I said, it's important that we calibrate our spends in this space. It's not like a free-for-all spends that I can do, because at the end of the day, there's a business model that, whether it is e-commerce-led or digital or physical, there's a business model that we follow in terms of being able to understand the ROIs and therefore the expenses that we put. This digital space or the e-commerce space, what it offers to you is a quick calibration of whether your effort is turning into result or not in two particular angles. One is, it gives you a very quick feedback around the consumer. Is the consumer appreciating your product or not? And therefore, it gives you the confidence to be able to spend more monies if you're getting a very positive review. Second, I think, is it is not like committed monies that are for long term. These are scalable modular expenses that you do. So these are campaigns that you can build modular. You don't need to be able to commit to a longer time. You can actually take one step at a time and build the whole portfolio. So in my mind, if you had asked me, this is the e-commerce space or the digital space is very clearly an opportunity that is available for startups and entrepreneurs to test their business model and test their ideas and be able to scale it up in a scientific way. Going overboard may not happen. Will it give you the right ROIs? And if you were to look at it, if you look at digital marketing, which is not necessarily the e-commerce space alone, the reason why I think digital marketing is taking time to scale up, minus the e-commerce platforms, if I were to look at saying, would you invest for your online offline brands? Would you invest on online? That space is taking some time. Because in that space, we are not getting the ROIs, or we don't have visibility of the money spent versus the return on investment. It is purely becoming a complementary model to your mainstream. However, there are certain segments of consumers where we believe consumers have started moving completely online. For example, a lot of millennials, they don't watch television. They don't read newspapers on your physical format. The millennials are largely mobile-based, iPads of the world-based, tablets-based, maybe YouTube-based to some extent. Even YouTube is passé. Even Facebook, for that matter, is passé with some of the millennials, right? So I think there are segments to whom digital marketing is very clearly a dominant channel to invest. There are segments to which digital is becoming a complementary channel. However, in the e-commerce space, where the shopping is happening, you can spend a lot more monies and get the bang for your buck. So I think I would split the discussion into e-commerce separate and digital communication separate. Digital communication is evolving It will take some more time. The e-commerce space, I think, is quite evolved. There are a lot of models available today that help you measure your return on investment. And therefore, I think if I were to be betting on it, I would definitely bet. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. So there's a question of through this digital channel, how do we approach the customers?
So approach,
they've mentioned to prove our, at least in the initial stage, to prove our stability, they want to know how to approach.
So I think today the best way today is some of these platforms that are available, because I think going on your own is too costly. The best way today is some of the platforms that are available today, and the platforms offer independent opportunities for new players as well. They don't necessarily need to be a part of the platform ecosystem. You could be a vendor. And so some of our new products, for example, we launch it as Kevin Care. Kevin Care is the partner who's actually delivering it to the consumer. So I think these channels offer you a lot of space for you to experiment with the launch. And therefore, I think understanding that space, the first thing that I would say is, don't hesitate to understand this space. Learn the space. As you learn the space, you will find opportunities that come your way. And therefore, we can launch products and brands. Then as you scale up, you can actually take the help of the partners to scale it up faster. So I have seen a lot of informal categories where a lot of my friends, a lot of people have started businesses in these marketplaces, and they actually do the whole marketing themselves. The marketing could be done offline. Marketing could be done in Facebook. Marketing gets done in Instagram. You could do physical ads and push people to the digital space. Be a part of the ecosystem. I would say, don't be worried. I think you should be a part of the ecosystem. Learn the ecosystem. As you start learning the ecosystem, I'm sure you'll be able to experiment a lot more and keep moving. But be patient. It's not like a one-day match or a T20. It is a marathon. It will not be won in a day. You will have to pace it out, but I'm sure you will get opportunities to win.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I think we have covered all the questions. You have almost covered in all the questions that are there on the chat with your answers. One is that what are the channels that are available for digital marketing if you have? What are the best ways? What are the best channels to go to for a B2C product?
So there are many channels evolving. The execution of the order is happening only through e-commerce platforms today, be it Amazon, Nykaa, maybe a Flipkart, maybe companies' own websites. The execution is happening on a platform. However, the communication, like I said, the discovery of the product is happening in multiple levels. When I say multiple levels, hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. When I say multiple levels, like I said, you could actually look at communities. There are people or there are companies who are actually building communities. So if the community is one part of your focus area, you could actually build your brands through communities. There are brands which are built through content. For example, there are brands which are using the OTT platforms to create their communication awareness. Some of the brands use YouTube extensively. Some of them use the print media, but divert the traffic to digital. Some of them use newspapers and print media, but go. So it's a combination that can happen. But what I've seen very clearly is the ability to be able to segment consumers and reach to them. For example, I've seen a lot of women, right? People I know, my close circles. If I were to look at my close circle of 100 people, in that 100 people space, when I look at purchase behaviors of people at different strata, people are very clearly getting influenced by Instagram today, right? Instagram as a media is actually influencing a lot of purchase decisions. Now, why not Instagram? I've seen a lot of brands which are only present in Instagram. I've seen a lot of brands which are present only in YouTube. So I think it is about we understanding our consumers. Where is our consumer sitting today? And can I go talk to my consumers? Like I said, for example, moms. you could go into mom related community, right? You could go to, if it is millennials, you could go to Instagram. Now within Instagram, there are so many other influencers that you have. Influencers is a big part of the whole game. A lot of, we don't go to celebrities today. The other big difference is digital brands don't need celebrities from the film world. What they need are digital celebrities. A lot of brands leverage digital celebrities, and digital celebrities come in different forms and packets. So I think the whole space is available to be experimented. There's no one answer. The answer lies in saying, this is my core consumer. This consumer, can I attack this consumer by actually leveraging some of the digital communication platforms? That's the way I would put it.
Thank you, sir. So but another question is on the digital marketing strategy for B2B versus B2C. What is the difference?
See, there is a difference because B2C is in a way influencing a single consumer. And therefore, the way you look at it is far different from the way you would do a B2B. B2B still evolves around decision-making, and in a way, e-commerce in B2B or B2B in e-commerce is becoming a little more tougher than B2C. Because in B2C, you have influencing capabilities that you can build in. In B2B today, you don't have that influencing capability because it's becoming a pricing game. At the end of the day, in B2B, there's a lot of personality selling that we do. I mean, when I sit in front of my client, the way I influence the client through my relationships is far different from the way I'm probably going to do it over a platform. But what digital has done today, and we've seen this in Kevin Care today. Kevin Care, we deploy a lot of reverse auction methodologies today. We don't see our suppliers face to face. They are part of an ecosystem where they come, they bid. And if the bid wins, they get it. So in a way, it's becoming far more transparent. The dynamics of B2B is therefore very different from the dynamics of B2C. B2B, in my mind, is far more difficult in the digital space. It needs a lot more understanding. It needs a lot more rigor that needs to be established. Erstwhile relationship models in B2B probably may not be as relevant in the e-commerce space today. And that I see is at a big difference. B2C to B2B, I see that as a big difference. And when companies therefore want to operate in the B2B space in e-commerce, they can operate as B2B to C. That's a different model. But if you want to be a pure play B2B guy, that I think is, you need to do a lot more homework before you could get into that space.
Thank you, sir. Any other questions, audience? A lot of the questions are more on the digital marketing and the strategy for it.
Yeah. See, I should frankly acknowledge I'm not a master in this. Like I said, all of us are learning. I think it's a little bit of what experiences we have collected over a period of time is what I'm explaining. Digital marketing in my mind needs a very clear ability of the organization, the entrepreneur, founder, spend a lot of time understanding the space. That's equally more important. Yeah.
So any other questions or we can wind up the session? If there aren't any. Someone's asking if you can refer any blog or book for digital marketing.
It wouldn't be particular. I think the way I do it is, there's a lot of reading material available across the net on different parts of digital marketing. There's no one source, like I said, who'd be a master. I think I rely a lot upon search and reading upon articles and materials that can come. A lot of new age, even in this space, a lot of new age companies are evolving. So to that extent, I think the internet is your best guru as far as digital marketing is concerned. I haven't come across any one person or any one book that actually becomes a compendium for recommending for a digital marketing one. I would say that I think you should pick up your own choices, learn it extensively, and there's enough and more material across available. However, case studies are good when you go to some of the established players. Case studies can be available, but I think it's more important that you use the internet to be able to leverage that space far more better.
Thank you, sir. I think we'll take the last question for the evening. It's from Silesh. He wants to ask you the question.
Yeah.
Hi, sir. Thanks again for the opportunity. So my question is that for any digital marketing space or thing, definitely we need to set up a whole lot of things, right? So do you see any saturation point? Like, we are in the beginning, but you know, don't you see that you know, when everyone is coming to online, don't you see any kind of saturation you know, will happen in some time, and then next technology take over, and anything like that, you see?
See, I think, like I said, the business model doesn't change. Consumer at the end of the day is in the center of the proposition. Mm-hmm. Products that you offer and brands that you build, that doesn't change. Evolving technologies can come in. Now, for example, augmented reality is something that we're seeing today. In a country like Korea today, people on the move order their product. By the time they reach the house, the product is available. There are three-dimension led technologies available where you're virtually actually experiencing the product before you order it. So in a way, technology is going to be able to improve the consumer experience even more and more and more. To that extent, I think the challenge is always going to be with us as entrepreneurs, as people running businesses. The challenge is going to be for us to adopt the technology well. But is there a saturation point? I think the answer is no. Right?
All right,
sir. I would only say that it keeps on building. And to that extent, I think all of us need to keep learning this again and again. Now, I would foresee, for example, 5 years down the line, if all of us were to meet again and have a conversation, probably we will still be talking about digital marketing, but in a different form. All that right. Is the norm that I would say.
All right. Thank you.